Battling for a top eight position, the North Queensland Cowboys laid on 3 tries in 15 minutes after halftime against Newcastle to level the scores. A field goal attempt from Nathan Fenn then bounced off the crossbar as the game went into golden point territory. Starting the second of 2 5-minute periods, disaster for the Knights.
It will come down to Kennedy, who knocked it up. Picked up by Fenn. He gives it to Norton. Can you believe the Cowboys win like that?
And that moves North Queensland into the eight and leaving Newcastle fighting for its season.
We always knew Newcastle was tough, and they've probably been a bit like ourselves. We're in a bit of indifferent form. We'd lost 3 out of our last 4. But we knew if we played good enough that we're in with a shout, and we give ourselves every chance.
You know, we've been in every game that we've sort of contested in these situations, and we're not coming off on the right side of the ledger, which, as I said, has an impact on your year.
Rugby league, it's a case of don't blame us, blame your players. That's the NRL's view tonight after another weekend of clubs and coaches blowing up over refereeing decisions. Officials are only admitting to one mistake and say players need to show more respect.
As much as Danny Bedeiras tried to cool down with a swim, the Knights and their skipper are still seething at what they feel was some rough justice handed out by rookie referee Jason Robinson in their loss to the Cowboys.
He'd love to have time back and rethink things, but in the heat of the moment, it's pretty hard. Like I said, you see your season slipping away, and it was a must-win game for us.
Bedeiras' running battle with Robinson comes as many clubs question whether the code's match officials are in crisis.
I think it's probably just because it seems to have all come out in one weekend. I think every game there's a controversial thing.
The players say they're sick of the video referees' haphazard involvement.
I'm not sure what the solution is, but we need to fix it before the finals.
Reg Reagan calls to bring back the biff, and Danny Williams does just that. But was Reg to blame? Isn't he just a make-believe character created by former Newcastle and Cronulla star Matty Johns? The Outrage Brigade are also slamming Reg's new book as smutty with the rampant male chauvinism. Is this your book, Fitzgerald?
No.
Lewd sexual references.
My book is Kikoda.
Homophobic remarks and obscene language not appropriate for a sport trying to rebuild its image. Well, I mean, Reg is a parody, isn't he?
Reg is a parody, Mike.
He's a throwback.
Can I use this opportunity to give
rip into him again.
I'll give a spray to Danny Wheedler.
He's a great man and I love him.
Danny, the best thing I can say about Danny Wheedler is that he's a journalist for the Herald. He gave me a spray in the paper on the weekend, Mike. Danny said about the Matthew Johns cake that on last week's show, I couldn't see the funny side of things and that I was jealous of Reg's success. What I said on a few occasions last week was that I think that the Reg Reagan character is a very funny character, and I just made the point that perhaps in these troubled times, someone who's got a mantra of bring back the biff might come under a bit of scrutiny. And I think that what happened over the last 7 days of media coverage, Mike, is that it was a fairly accurate bloody prediction, don't you think? A lot of column inches were written, and
so
a lot
you're
of
jealous, you're not jealous. And if I might say,
mate, I think, Matty, I think it's a fun character. I
mean, Danny Wheedler made a very good point, totally kosher, totally 100% right
which
on
was?
The money, which was, you're jealous. You hate him going so well with his DVD. You hate that. You've made money out of making fun out of
drinking,
commentators.
I was drinking with Matty Johns' management and record company on Friday, and we were all slapping it up and saying, isn't it unbelievable how well this character's done? We're talking about chart positions for albums.
Yeah, look,
we're talking about chart
judge.
Positions for DVDs. I think it's a funny character.
So there's no controversy at all.
The only controversy is that Danny's made a fatal journalistic mistake, which is obviously, the story came via a mate, Danny, and you didn't watch the show.
Oh, all right, it was me. Okay, look, stop me before I kill again. I told Danny.
Let's get back to the subject at hand.
Does
anybody treat Reg Reagan in any way seriously? And his book, I mean,
yes, they do.
Sure it's going to be smutty. I mean, he's a smutty little character.
I ask you, Dennis Fitzgerald is the CEO of one of the biggest rugby league teams in town. He's come out and left absolutely no doubt about his feelings. I'm not a fan of the Reg Reagan character, he says. I think it's a dinosaur character. It takes the game into
yes,
the dark.
Yes, but if anybody takes Reg Reagan seriously, they should go and see Nathan Gibson get their head examined.
He's missed the gag.
What it does, it shows how far we've come. I mean, he's self-deprecating. It shows how far we've come. And if you don't want to read it, Don't read it. It's a parental responsibility whether your kid reads that book. I mean, to draw a comparison between Danny Williams and Reg Regan is preposterous.
On a serious note, Billy, did you ever take any flack from either the commentators or the ACB thinking, saying that your stuff... Yeah, did you?
I'm always copping flack.
But did anybody launch a torpedo, the chairman of the ACB or anybody like that, saying this is not the image of cricket we want?
No.
No?
No, 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 no. Well, I think the 12th man character and all the... I mean, obviously, I don't take any prisoners on those records. Anyone who's heard them would realise that. But I haven't run into the potential problem, though, of having a mantra like Bring Back the Biff, and then just as... I mean, this is the point I made last week. Just as Matty's CD and his DVD have gone apeshit, all of a sudden...
No, we don't say
all of a sudden, we have violence and Biff being headlines. And I just knew that people would draw the comparison.
Should
and they have.
Should they draw that comparison?
Well, no, I think that I think that Matty's character is basically... for an adult audience. And if people can't exercise a bit of parental responsibility and say, no, Joey, you can't, read this book or whatever.
That's Reg's little brother.
Is it?
Marge asked.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, Matty, you've had more than enough publicity.
Yeah,
good luck
free publicity,
to you. Love you.
Send us a DVD.
Good on you, Danny Widler. Good
AFL
piece.
And...
After the game, Russell Fairfax spoke with a dejected Ben Kennedy.
Tough question, and I hope you excuse me, but what did the referee say when you tossed that ball down underneath the sticks here and gave a penalty? Did he say play? Did you hear him say anything?
No, I never heard a thing. That tackle sort of went on forever, and I thought the momentum was going with me, and they were still wrestling me, so I thought if they're still wrestling me, I can pass the ball, and I passed the ball, and I didn't even hear him blow the whistle or penalise us. I thought Robbie O was stepping and on his way, and, there was a penalty there somewhere, so I don't know.
And I guess the other one, the kickoff just didn't quite go right.
Yeah, no, I dropped the ball. Simple as that. That happens.
It certainly did yesterday.
Look, get there.
There's been a bit of controversy, of course. Oh. Reg Regan, in light of the Danny Williams incident, has been copying plenty of crap from certain people. And so what Channel 9 did, they got Reg on with, of course, the great Ray Martin.
I tell you
with
what,
the great Ray Martin on a current affair during the week. Here it is.
All right, he is colourful, he's controversial, his sporting prowess is legendary. A rugby league great, the toast of the cricket world, and a champion surfer. Reg Regan saved Manchester United...
Ray, enough. You're gibbering, OK? If I wanted to listen to gibberish, I'd have stayed home and watched SBS. Let's get on with this interview.
Reg, don't get aggro. No need to get aggro, mate.
I've got an aggro, man.
I know. Okay. Are you a violent man?
Ray, I'm not a violent man, OK? I'm not a violent man. I refute that. What sort of sensationalism is this? I'm not a violent man, Ray.
Oh, I understand. Keep it. I know.
I like it when two big blokes stand toe-to-toe and have a bit of a go, face-to-face. That wasn't face-to-face. That was a cheap shot, Ray. Do you know what a cheap shot is, Ray? I don't think you do, Ray. I'll show you in a minute.
Well, the Olympics in a couple of weeks' time. Any tips for Athens? You're a bit of a Greek god yourself, aren't you?
I am a bit of a Greek. Did you know, here's a bit of trivia for the old viewers out there. Did you know that in the ancient Greek Olympics, they used to perform in the nude? Did you know that? Can you imagine old Roger boy running down the street in the nude? They'd poke someone's eye out.
Now, Reg, I've got to ask, because there is so much criticism. Let me come back to you and bring back the Biff, the fact that you're not a good role model for kids anymore. You shouldn't be doing this.
Ray, have we got freedom of speech in this country?
Of course.
Now, what's happened to this country? Sometimes I think we're living in Eastern Europe or bloody New Zealand or something, OK? We have freedom of speech. I can basically say as I like. For instance, Ray, hey, nice wig, buddy. Nice wig. Let's just find out. Hey, don't miss this, the viewers don't.
We've got to launch your book.
Reg Regan, This Is My Life, comes out on Friday at all good, bad and sleazy bookstores, OK? Oh, you're a good bloke, Ray. No, you are a good bloke.
Thanks.
God, I miss the Navy, Ray.
Boys, Reggie Boy said to me, he said, Matty, I might sniff another 10,000 heads, but it's the top of the iceberg.
That's as good as it gets.
Yeah, you get right.
So you dispelled a myth. It's actually not a wig. Reg has dispelled that myth.
There was industrial...
It's not a rug.
Industrial strength glue was under there. I mean, wiped it off my mouth.
Good on you, Reg. Great bloke, Ray Martin. Of course, The Current Affair on 6:30 every night during the week. Thanks, Pete. Now, it would appear the last few weeks that taking a dive has become a part of the game. It never happened back in the 80s, of course. You just got up no matter what happened. If you head the knock off, you put it under your thing, you get up and play the ball.
For everyone talks about yesteryear with Rose. I remember, what about the old 2 minutes to go, the cramp, all that? That's faking it. That's faking it. Good. So you're with me?
Yeah, mate. I don't agree with what's going on today, but I admit it's pretty average.
But I'm saying, like, it's not.
What are you trying to say? Right. The 80s are soft.
Sure they are. No, but it's not something that's new in the game.
Isn't
we've always
talking about happened. The 80s.
Sorry.
Isn't Reg always talking about the 80s? And the
70s.
The problem 70s. Is, if someone is seriously hurt, you yeah. can't be accusing him no, to stay sure. down, that's and so you can't be got. Dragging him up to play it.
Sure. What we did, though, we sent an expert on faking it out into the streets.
Faking what?
Trent, the flight steward.
Hi guys, Trent here in the bowels of Rooter territory, and it seems like Coach Dicky Stewart, the boys, aren't happy chappies. And why? Because they believe some of the players have been faking it. Give me a break. I've been faking it for 5 years, haven't I, Jason? So let's hit the streets and find out from some of the gorgeous locals. Buddy, what did you think of that Shane Warne's performance on the weekend, laying down?
It's a bit of a disgrace, mate. He should be playing soccer in Europe, I think.
What do you think Luke Rigatham was saying to him?
I don't know. I reckon he's either going to jump on the back of him or tell him to get up before he did.
I'll take A, thank you very much. Geez, Rico was really angry. Has anyone ever faked anything on you?
Plenty of people have faked things on me, mate.
Male, female?
Both.
Have you ever faked anything in your life?
Maybe an orgasm.
Truly?
Oh! Oh!
Ha! Ha! Ha!
Ha! Ha! Ha! Ha! Oh, it can't be that.
Yeah!
Oh, my God! Oh!
God! Makes the man want to start batting for the other team! Last weekend in the rugby league, there are a lot of guys falling on the ground and faking it. Like, oh! Have you girls ever faked anything in your life?
Of course.
Anything?
Of course. Can you? I'm faking with my husband all the time.
What's your take on players faking it at the moment?
I reckon it's wrong, mate. It goes on too much.
I bet it happens a lot in your house. So you are a faker.
Only once. I was working 32 years in a meat game, and I.
Tell me more.
And I told
me too. I've been doing it for 35 years.
Yeah. And I was.
Do you like salami?
Yeah, I like salami. I like Danish salami. I like the best thing I like is cabanossi.
You eat it much?
Yeah, I eat a fair bit when I have a beer or another wine. I eat cabanossi.
I love salami.
I love it. You know the best salami to get is Spanish hot or Danish or Milano. Oh. But cabanossi and the pepperoni is really hot. You like that one too, mate. You like that too, my friends.
God, it's on seasonal weather at the moment.
It is
so isn't hot.
It? Yeah. So hot, and some days it's so cold. Yeah.
You ever faked anything in your life? God, they're big bags. Oh, God, I miss Jason Stevens. Well, what about yourself? You ever faked anything in your life?
I did, as a matter of fact, once, but I got caught.
Now, come on, okay, now, buddy. Give me what I paid for, okay?
Yeah, how about this here?
And I want something from my little buddy Jason, okay?
Yeah, I got a little chipolata just sprung up.
God, I miss Jason. That Shane Walker on the weekend, laying down, faking it in front of Rico. What did you think of that?
Reminds me of you.
This reminds me of you. Well, if you ask me, I don't know what the fuss is all about. You show me someone who hasn't faked it, and I'll run down the main street of Bondi Junction totally naked. Hey, I might just do that anyway. I'm Trent, checking out. Ciao for now.
A mid-season slump has been gnawing away at Newcastle's confidence. They needed to beat South Sydney to restore their hopes of making the eight. And the Rabbitohs led by four at half-time.
South Sydney have scored 2 tries in 6 minutes.
It was 22-all with 20 to go. The Knights finishing the stronger with 5/8 Kurt Gidley instrumental, having a hand in 3 tries and bagging a field goal.
Gidley, long ball, nice ball. Try to Craig Hall.
After a couple of losses, you know, you start to doubt yourself, I suppose. And after a win like today, you know, all the confidence comes flowing back.
After Manly's win today, South now sit alone at the bottom of the ladder. The rest of their season won't just be dedicated to avoiding the wooden spoon.
It's not our priority. All we're trying to do right now is to build on our future. And
let's have a look at the ladder after round 21. The Roosters and Bulldogs are level at the top. North Queensland are right in contention for the finals after moving up to 6th. St George, Illawarra and Canberra, they round out the top 8. Now Newcastle and West Tigers and the Sharks are still a chance of making the 8. Further back, Manly and the Warriors leapfrog Souths.
in the race for the wooden spoon.
All right, we've got some rugby league coming up. We'll spend some time with the master Andrew Johns and his apprentice, Kurt Gidley.
And Kylie is back on the other side of the break to bring you up to date with all the latest sports news.
That's this year's campaign over. I'm not going to the Olympics. I won't be winning.
Here's a good break down the short side. Kurt Gidley will score.
Now, even my little son, all he talks about is Kurt. Now, up in the bedroom between Tyrannosaurus Rex and Nemo is a big picture of Kurt.
Well, this week, injured Newcastle Rugby League captain Andrew Johns listed his Fab Four, a group of players he believes can carry the Knights to the NRL playoffs.
Well, one of the four is Kurt Gidley, a man who in the past couple of years has slipped from outside the shadow of Johns to prove he's a force to be reckoned with. Michelle Kieran has more.
Kurt Gidley, dummies, leans out. It's a try, all right.
I see a lot of property qualities in Kurt that was probably in me when I was his age.
Johns has got it.
100 mile an hour.
Kurt Gidley scores!
Just wanted to know everything that's going on, just loving footy that much. Can't stop addicted
to the shindig. After years of playing in the shadow of rugby league's number one man, Kurt Gidley's rise to the top has been sudden.
A massive blow to Newcastle, to New South Wales.
When Andrew Johns succumbed to a series of career-threatening injuries, Gidley stepped into halfback, a role that Johns owned for over a decade.
Yeah, it was a big surprise. I was still working, actually, as a butcher, an apprentice butcher, so I just got a call on him over, and it was Nick Hagan, so I said I'm all right to play.
Oh, fibrates.
Gone.
A 22-year-old and the world's greatest player. Don't be fooled, these guys are rivals for one position.
Oh, yeah.
But Johns recognises Gidley as an exceptional talent. So much so, he's not just a mate, but also a mentor.
Kurt. Have another one. Yeah, I suppose so. Definitely, you know, look out for him and we get along great. We've gone away a few times surfing, gone on holidays together. So, I look out for him and we train together and give him as much tips as I can. He's playing that well, that proud of the way he's going. He's braining.
Good, Gidley.
I felt, privileged to have him there and to learn everything of him. So I suppose other clubs and other young players around Australia don't get that opportunity. So it's definitely pretty special to have the world's best player teach you what he knows.
Kurt Gidley's to the right. 30
he is
out.
Indeed. He gives himself plenty of depth. Gets the kick away.
It's over.
I think it's cleared.
It's over.
The bar. It's cleared the bar. It's a point. Newcastle has won it. Kurt Gidley.
I like to take interest in a lot of the young blokes coming through, especially if they show the desire Kurt shows. It's nice when he comes and asks for help and we go train together, and you can see that he generally loves training and wanting to be successful in footy, so that's pretty much where it started from there.
Newcastle is arguably rugby league's finest nursery.
The Knights have edged ahead once again.
There's an endless list of representative players, and this year Kurt joined that elite rank.
Yeah, it was a big surprise being named for country. And, I was on the bench and come on sort of 5 or 6 minutes into the game. It was just good to be out there and mix it in my first game of rep footy.
The country have claimed a try, I think, about you, Kurt Gidley.
No, I was over the moon for him, because I suppose I've had a bit to do with his career and also his brother. So, I was really happy, and I actually went down to the City Country match and watched him, and speaking to Ricky Stewart after it, he was blown away by how professional he was in camp and how much you could see, probably the same as me, how much he loved footy.
It's fair to say Johns knows a thing or two about the game he's mastered so well. He's predicting Gidley's life at the top will be long.
Club-wise, he'll go on captain the club without doubt in the next, the next 4 or 5 years. That'll be the next big thing for him.
A pretty big call coming from someone like Joey Johns.
Yeah, for sure, it's a pretty big call. And, there's plenty of, superstars and in New South Wales and Australian players that have been there that have captained Newcastle in the past. So it's definitely something to aspire to, that's for sure.
Now, even my little son, all he talks about is Kurt. You know, up in his bedroom between Tyrannosaurus Rex and Nemo is a big picture of Kurt. So I occasionally remind him that I used to play footy, but he doesn't believe me.
You're going right with you between Nemo and the Tyrannosaurus Rex.
I was going to say, he said a lot of good things there, and then he put him straight in between Nemo and Tyrannosaurus Rex. I don't know where that leaves him, half fish, half dinosaur.
Well, the Knights played the Raiders last night at Energy Australia Stadium. Both teams desperate to stay in the top eight. And it was a pretty close game. Knights end up winning. They've won two in a row now. But straight from the first half, probably the Raiders played a little bit better. But this was against the run of play. The Knights put a kick up, knocked back there by Craig Hall. And Mark McLinden showed a great bit of speed here. Early in this first half, he copped a knock off Craig Hall. It was dead set one of the best hits I've ever seen. Had the ability to turn around and score a good try. Now, later in this first half, a little short play there on the short side with Steve Witt. And Craig Hall went over again. I tell you what, he's playing better. Him and George Carmot have been great pickups. This break here from Adam Woolnow was just outstanding. He's had a real impact when he come on. Picked the ball up there, got a nice pass away to set up a try. I thought him and probably Josh Perry played best they've played for a while. This guy, Mick Innes, is leading the Newcastle Knights. He's one of the most talented guys I've seen in a long, long time. Really ambitious. He's going to Manly next year. Crucial one here from the Newcastle Knights. Matty Gidley threw a pretty ordinary pass, put the Raiders right back in. There was no problem with their effort in this game. The Raiders are really a try hard. This try here was contentious. Now, there's a bit of thought here that Mick Innes, you'll see in a minute, when he dropped this ball,
it was a drop kick.
But drop kick is fine. You can do it anywhere on the field, and he had it in full control, so that is a try. And I'll tell you what, Mick Hagan really panicked the last 5 or 6 minutes because instead of wrapping the game up professionally, the boys still wanted to throw the ball around and made it a bit tough for him. But Raiders showed plenty of guts there. Look, I was in the dressing sheds after the game with both teams, and I had a bit of a look at them and had a yarn to them. Check this out.
Oh, that was a pretty tough effort actually on the part of both teams. I thought it was a real battle in the first half. We're down by four, and I thought we worked pretty hard. And I just thought we got a bit of momentum after half time. In a possession, we might give ourselves a chance to get our nose in front, and it was a real battle to the end. So, we're just really happy to win the game and still be in the hunt.
Towards the end, you had the game pretty all wrapped up in a sense, but you made it hard. You really threw the ball around. Possession was a bit of a problem.
Yeah, I think we panicked a bit and when we didn't need to. I think it was 16-8 there, and all we needed to do was complete our sets and find touch or wind the clock down. But instead, it was like we're chasing our tails. But I don't know. We got the 2 points and very happy about it, mate.
Mate, first half was pretty good. You come in at half time. What was said?
Oh, we were pretty positive at halftime. We were a little disappointed with the try they scored right on halftime. Sort of let them back into it a bit, but we just come up with too much drop ball in the second half at vital periods. The effort was there. Compared to last week, we had great effort, but just lacked the execution, mate.
Mate, what about looking to the future? Hard one, I know you don't like doing it, but leading to the semi-finals, everything's still online. You happy?
Yeah, it looks like we've lost Luke DeVico for the season, so that's not a great result for us, but. The one thing that you never do at this organisation is give up, and that's certainly not what we're going to do. We're going to work our backsides off this week and do our very, very best to get a result next week versus Melbourne, and then we get a shot at the competition leaders the following week, and we get a break then. So I can't wait. Looking forward to it all.
Have we hit rock bottom? Are we on the way up?
Well, I guess the effort over the last 4 weeks has been pretty good. We've won two and narrowly lost the other two, so the effort's been fantastic by our players and they're putting in and still giving themselves a chance, and we want to make something for the rest of the year. So she's on again next week.
Thanks, Chief. Excellent work, mate. Good interviews. And, of course, there's the Chief with the Newcastle socks on and the hush puppies.
Mate, I wear them to bed. Nothing on the hush puppies.
What exactly, when you're looking at the boys in the showers, what exactly impressed you with
mate,
the
actually,
Newcastle?
Actually, there's a bit of impressiveness from both sides. But when I meant look, I was meant have a yarn. Oh, okay, I'm not checking enough, the boys okay. out in the shower.
And Mike Lennis, champ.
He's not going to Manly. I said he was going to Manly. Of course, he is going to St. George. And I tell you what, he's going to be a good buy because he wants to play. He wants to play first grade. He wants to play hooker, and of course, Danny Medeiros is in front of him, so he's moved to the Dragons, and he'll go very, very well.
But the next request is a good question from Connor O'Neill of Pennant Hills. He asks, "Has anyone ever fallen over on the team runout?" What a good question that is, Gus.
Yeah, don't know about players, Vossie, but I got some nice vision here from a Newcastle game.
Right.
Have a look at this. The Knights will run through the banner. You can see the ball boy there loses his hat. But on closer inspection, watch the fellow on the right holding the banner.
Okay.
He gets a little bit of a recall effect there and
yep,
he's gone.
He fell over. The players were okay.
What a shame.
The Canberra Knights match went down to the wire. Nathan Smith getting the Raiders within 2 points. Hours later, he was arrested for obscene exposure and resisting arrest. Newcastle grabbing the win, though, but a controversial Michael Ennis kick resulting in the match-winning try.
This is so hard to pick.
I'm quite sure that if I was Mick Hagan, I would be saying that, yeah, it was just a drop kick.
You would call it a drop kick, I guess, even though it may not have been intended to be a drop kick.
This is how Michael Hagan saw the decision to award that try.
Well, my thought was that we should have probably passed it. That was my first thought. It was 3-on-1, perhaps, but and I wasn't really thinking about the kick. I was worrying about the put down, but I guess there was a fair element of control in respect to the dropping of the footy and making contact with it. So, effectively, you would call it a drop kick, I guess, even though it may not have been intended to be a drop kick. But you'd almost need to have to change the laws a bit if you're going to argue that one.
Which is what you're suggesting, Russell.
Oh, well, I don't want to see any laws change. I don't want to see another law change in this game for 10 years. I think we changed too many laws. But in saying that, what the referee's got to do is get it right. I thought it was a knock-on. You thought it was a drop kick. That's fine by me. I was happy either way. But you asked me for my opinion. Whether they change the rules, nah, that's not a chance.
No chance at all. Well, Knights coach Michael Hagan was asked at the media conference if Newcastle's bid for the eight is over.
No, it's definitely not over for us, but today's game was extremely important to where we sit and obviously where we sit with a couple of other teams. And we knew that it's a tough three-game period to finish off with. It's definitely still something for us to play for, and I think we're probably a little bit wounded today. We've got a couple of front rowers that are struggling with a couple of serious things, but we've got an opportunity to turn things around like Manly did, and we've got a couple of home performances to look forward to.
It is a very quick turnaround though this Friday night, isn't it?
Yeah, and they do take on the Dragons, and there is some rivalry there between those two clubs. It'd be very difficult to see how they could turn it around. They haven't been playing their best. They have got some major injury concerns, whereas the Dragons are starting to get a few players back.
Tim, a big story that'll break probably tomorrow, an extraordinary snub for one of Newcastle's favourite sons. I believe Robbie O'Davis was offered the paltry sum of $8,000 to play with the Newcastle Knights next year. I'm sure you'll read more about that later.
Yeah, we will. Thank you, Tony. Tony Peters.
And in other news, a short time ago I spoke to Newcastle fullback Robbie O'Davis, who is tonight considering his future after being offered a paltry $8,000 by the club to play on next year. Now, the club say that's all they could afford under the salary cap, and naturally O'Davis is shattered and considering his future.
I've got to be honest, I shed a few tears, but maybe he'll become a better person. I don't know. But at the same time, I'm looking forward to the future.
The 31-year-old former Queensland Origin fullback received the offer through his manager last Friday, who held it back from O'Davis, fearing that it would affect the way he played last weekend. I've no doubt O'Davis is not saying as much, but he does see it as a major slap in the face.
It was, and I don't know what. I think it was pretty much just saying we're making an attempt, but we don't want you, sort of thing, maybe.
O'Davis says he feels good enough to go around one more year but will never play against Newcastle. England is an option, but with a young daughter in Newcastle, it is unlikely he'd make that move. That's the Rugby League news tonight.
And Newcastle's Robbie O'Davis coming to terms with life after big money football. The Newcastle Knights have refuted reports they offered fullback Robbie O'Davis a paltry $8,000 to play next season. The club say Robbie O was told some time ago he would not be required beyond this season.
After 13 years and 218 games with the Knights, Robbie O'Davis is now coming to terms that it's all over. O'Davis was angry with the Knights and their supposed offer of $8,000, all they had left to spend under the salary cap.
I'm going to make sure that there's no bad feelings between myself and the Knights, because there is none, and that I don't leave with any regrets.
The Knights made it clear upgrading younger player contracts was their priority.
It was probably pointed out a little while ago, and the likelihood of us being able to keep him
was very remote given what we have to work in, and that situation probably hasn't changed a great deal.
At 31, O'Davis must now face the reality of life without money from football.
The disappointment is just because my body's feeling so good, I suppose, at the moment. And to go from, in any sort of job, to have a wage, you know, coming in, week out, and then sort of all of a sudden, at the end of the football career, the wage just stops.
O'Davis wanted a new contract to break Tony Butterfield's club record of 229 games. Robbie O'Davis will be officially farewelled here in round 26 against the West Tigers. After that, it's retirement and life with his six-year-old daughter Keely and his local business interests. The Knights aren't happy with the timing of O'Davis' outburst, given their season is on the line tomorrow night.
It certainly doesn't help our situation with respect to the end of the season and the job we've got to do immediately, but you know, unfortunately that has came out in the wrong way.
Tony Peters, 10 News.
Tomorrow night, Newcastle host the Dragons. Unwanted by the Knights next season, veteran fullback Robbie O'Davis is contemplating retirement or playing on in England.
Let's work through the next 3 weeks and see if I hang the boots up or keep going.
And the Knights desperate to bounce back against the Dragons.
Tonight's game between the Knights and Dragons is crucial for Newcastle. The last time these teams met was round four, the Dragons winning 48 points to 2, but they concede at times they're their own worst enemy.
We've got great individuals, but as a team sometimes we don't click. The individuals can't win games for you.
Newcastle lost 48 to 10 against Manly last round, and the Knights cannot afford to drop another game.
I think it's getting to a stage where, you know, we need to win our games and probably relying on the other teams to fall away or lose a couple of games as well. So not an ideal position to be in, but that's the situation we're in at the moment.
Rob Canning, 10 News.
We'll also talk live to Newcastle coach Michael Hagan about tonight's clash with the Dragons. Friday night football is in Newcastle, where the Knights need to beat the hot and cold St George Illawarra to stay in the race for the finals. But that might be easier said than done, given the home side is severely under strength and they take on a Dragons outfit that hammered them 48 points to 2 back in round 4. I'm joined now by Newcastle coach Michael Hagan. And Michael, is it true that this is really a make or break game for you?
Yeah, it certainly is. I guess the loss last week to Manly has meant that we really need to win our last three games to give ourselves some chance of making the playoffs, so it's extremely important tonight.
It's unthinkable that you can't make a final series. You've been there since 1996.
Yeah, it's not a situation we've been in for a long time, but it's the type of year that we've had, and obviously we're up against it a bit tonight with the fact that a couple of our big men are out, but that's nothing unusual to us at this stage of the year.
The Dragons are hot and cold. When they're hot, they're really hot, and when they're cold, well, they can be just terrible. So I guess you're hoping they turn up cold tonight.
Yeah, they're probably striking a bit of form in the last couple of weeks, and they're looking pretty healthy. So I guess, you know, we've got our work cut out tonight against them, but we're in front of our home fans, and I guess the players looking for a big performance.
What do you expect from the team? Are you confident that they can come up with the ones with 10 major injuries?
I think it's just a matter of, you know, if we can start the game well and get through our sets, I think that's important, and just try and stay with them as long as we possibly can and make it a real arm wrestle from there on.
Michael, best of luck tonight. Michael Hagan in Newcastle. And don't forget that game, 8:30 tonight on 9. And that Knights-Dragons game's got everything going for it. Sounds like something medieval, Jim.
It'll be a bottler. Thanks, Ken.
As a supporter, as a coach and as a teammate, that's all you can ask. That's all you can ask from your team. Adversity tonight, credibility on the line after a loss, a big loss to Manly last week. The finals are beckoning if you can get a win. And against one of the most intimidating and brilliant sides in the competition, they've just kept coming, the Knights, and only just failed.
Andrew's out in the centre with the St George Illawarra captain.
Yeah, Trent Barrett. I watched Trent on full time, Ray, down on your haunches for all of 60 seconds, still catching your breath. You won't earn a harder 2 points than tonight. Nat was up against 12 men for 74 minutes.
It's disgusting. We were pretty awful. And against 12 blokes the first half, it was awful. I don't know what Browning will have to say to us in the dressing sheds. We got the 2 points, but against 12 men and to play with the ill discipline that we played with was pretty awful.
And your heart in the mouth right up through that final play.
Yeah, it was, and we deserved it, you know. And we didn't play well enough. It's going to be a long week, but still weren't one, so.
I'd like to join your teammate, Trent. Thanks.
Andrew, thank you for that. And there's a lonely figure, the young man that was sent off after 6 minutes in the game, Clint Newton. Let's go back to Andrew in the centre.
Yeah, Ray, with Kurt Gidley, you've got to remember a kick right on half time. We were questioning taking the shot at goal. That hits the post. We're looking at 24 all now, Kurt.
Yeah, I know. And to miss that last kick at the end as well was, you know, it comes back to hurt you, I suppose, but it's just pretty disappointing.
Listen to the chant right now, Kurt. The fans, the Newcastle chant for a side that's gone down by two. Your season's not over yet, is it? You've got this support behind you.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, we had to prove ourselves to the fans. You know, we're still a good team. We're probably disappointed this year at our home ground, which is, you know, unlike us. But, you know, they enjoyed tonight, but unfortunately we couldn't get a win for them.
We'll see you next Friday night, Kurt.
Yeah, thanks.
Kurt Gidley there with Andrew Voss as well. So to Kurt and to Trent after a battle, an enormous battle like that, we certainly say thank you. Post-match tonight, Ben Kennedy back for a well-earned rest with his teammates. Gee, there were some great efforts in the red and blue jumper. The Nutri-Grain Ironman of the match is part of post-match. Matthew Johns in both dressing rooms. Plus, we'll preview Sunday's big clash between the Storm and the Bulldogs. All of that, other side of the break.
Matty Johns is in the Newcastle room.
Down here in the Knights dressing room, first of all, on the injury front, Adam Warnow's got a shoulder injury, Luke Quigley's got a rib injury, and both are unlikely to play next week. We're going to have a talk, first of all, to the captain, Danny Beeris. I reckon you would have been proud to captain those blokes tonight.
Yeah, that was a great effort from the boys, and it's always hard to play against 12 men. That's St. George. Had to do tonight, so you know, it's really proud of the boys. And after last week, and you know, we've got 2 weeks to go, and hope we can take that into that the remaining games.
What went through the side when, you know, Nudo got sent off? You know, what happened there? Just boys pulled together.
Yeah, we just didn't want them to go through the middle, and as long as they went around us, which they scored most of their tries around us, so you know, that's all you can ask for, and just scramble, and we did that a lot of times tonight.
Thanks, Danny. And by the way, another great game from Danny Beeris. Michael Hagan. Same question. Must be very proud of the boys.
Yeah, it was a fantastic effort. We knew it was going to be tough on the back of last week. Number of blokes unavailable, and with 12 men for probably 70 minutes or more, you know, went within a whisker of pulling off a major upset.
A lot of good players on the bench as well, Hags.
Yeah, no, I thought young blokes off the bench did a great job, and we gave away a bit of size and strength, but you know, they competed fantastic, and I'm really happy with what they did.
Now, Mick, it comes down to the Dogs next week. They're on fire, but earlier in the year, they were playing well and you got them by 30 points, so there's optimism there.
Yeah, I guess, you know, we always play well against Canterbury, a bit like Saints and us. We always seem to play well against each other, and we've got a few blokes hopefully coming back to give us a bit of help. So, you know, we'll look forward to next Friday night and obviously try and finish the year off as well as we can.
Yeah, Michael Hagan there. All right, well, it's been an amazing night here in Newcastle. We've had players visiting opponents' dressing room midway through the first half. We've just had the two coaches come to the sideline for a late-night chat. Michael Hagan and Nathan Brown after just an amazing night here at Energy Australia Stadium. Both their teams still in finals contention. The Dragons sitting a little prettier than the Newcastle Knights. 24 points to 22. The Knights going down to the Dragons tonight. Until next time, enjoy your footy.
Friday Night Football on Nine's Wide World of Sports.
Hello, I'm Bill Woods. This is Sports Tonight. We're heading for home in the football. More big games with big trophies in sight.
Down here, Westy. Oh, yeah, it's Newton, all right.
That's sickening. We don't want to see that too often.
Today, sorry seems to be the hardest word.
Words can't probably describe how I was feeling throughout the game and after the game.
It was a bad night for Newcastle. The Dragons may not be breathing fire, but at least they're still breathing.
First up, NRL and St George Illawarra is supporting the Newcastle player who KO'd one of their forwards last night. Clint Newton's sickening elbow on Ashton Sims took the attention from a very fine match. The 12-man Newcastle team proved a real threat for the Dragons. It was a costly one too, with Jason Ryles out for a week with rib cartilage damage. St George Illawarra now into fourth place on the ladder. The NRL Match Review Committee will look at the Newton tackle on Monday.
This ugly blow may end Clint Newton's season.
There's no doubt that the elbow's been used. That's sickening.
It's another setback to the game's image in the wake of Danny Williams' shocking punch. The Newcastle forward full of regret after elbowing St George Illawarra's Ashton Sims in the seventh minute of the match.
Tragic mistake. As far as what happened, obviously I wouldn't like to relive it. Everything that happened was basically a bit of a blur and it still is even this morning.
With the Knights seemingly out of the finals race and only two rounds to play, Newton is facing a lengthy suspension after being sent off. His disappointment was obvious last night. Newton then checking on the welfare of Sims, who returned to the field in the second half.
We needed to win the game, probably to make the semi, so words can't probably describe how I was feeling throughout the game and after the game. So to leave my teammates down one man.
The tough Dragons forward showing no ill feeling today.
The only thing I'm filthy as I can't eat, so I like a good feed.
The 19-year-old was concussed, needing stitches in his face to repair a gash caused by his teeth tearing through his chin. But there were no fractures to his jaw, but he will visit a dentist to repair his rattled teeth. Surprisingly, the Dragons camp jumped to Newton's defence.
Is that one of the worst hits you've copped in your career?
Yeah, oh, I think so. I don't think my looks have done any good. So, he seems like a pretty good bloke, you know. So he came in apologising that yesterday, so I'm pretty happy with that.
Hopefully he doesn't get too long a suspension. And, it's just one of those unfortunate things. It's a bit of a brain snap. But like I said, it's a bit out of character for Clint to be doing that. Yeah.
We don't want to see Clint get hammered, you know. I mean, obviously if Ash had broke his jaw, we'd probably be sitting here, we'd probably be, a bit darker, but it's probably good for Clint and good for Ash that didn't happen.
In 10 years of football, Newton hasn't faced a judiciary or been suspended, and hopes this good record will help his case next week.
And he understands that it was a mistake, and there was no malice or no intention for that to happen.
Meanwhile, St George Illawarra coach Nathan Brown wants his team to improve their mental game after taking the Knights too lightly last night. He wants more consistent enthusiasm and intensity leading into the finals.
There's another try for Matthew Head!
We thought we were just going to turn up and win, and it doesn't work like that, and that was the most disappointing thing.
With the top four berth to play for, the Dragons struggling to finish off, the 12-man Newcastle team eventually winning 24-22.
Cooper, they won't catch Cooper. Put away the glasses.
It's round 24, 1999, and the Dragons farewell one of their best, Mark Coyne, before their big clash with Newcastle. And the match is a perler, as Dragons hooker Nathan Brown scores 3 minutes from full time to clinch what they thought would be a victory. But it would prove to be premature congratulations, with the magician Matthew Gidley conjuring up a try for the flying Darren Albert and a last gasp win.
Newcastle's Clint Newton has had his striking charge referred straight to the NRL judiciary after the night's ugly hit on St George Illawarra's Ashton Sims.
Newcastle's Clint Newton was referred straight to the judiciary after a sickening elbow to the head of Dragons prop Ashton Sims.
Newcastle's Clint Newton will throw himself at the mercy of the tribunal when he fronts on a striking charge. The Knights say there isn't much choice after his brain snap against the Dragons.
Yeah, difficult, I guess, at this stage from a defence point of view, but they'll be things that we look at over the next couple of days.
The Knights are resigned to losing Clint Newton. The prop faces the judiciary tomorrow night on an ungraded charge.
I think it's fair to say that we're going to miss him for a few weeks at least, and that obviously might impact on this year and maybe the start of next year.
Tony Peters, 10 years.
A blow for the Knights today as they prepare their case to defend Clint Newton at the judiciary tomorrow night. Newton is facing a lengthy suspension after being charged with striking. His club was hoping to use similar incidents from other games to help their cause, but that's been knocked on the head.
This is the incident the Knights were hoping to use in Newton's defence. It involves a high tackle by Mark Riddell on Brayton Astor 2 years ago. He was suspended for 4 games, and Newcastle was going to argue there's little difference between Riddell's hit and Newton's tackle last Friday. But a technical hitch has changed that. Incidents from last year and earlier can no longer be compared as charges and their penalty rates have changed.
And former golfer Jack Newton by his son's side as he faces a long suspension at the judiciary. Former golfer Jack Newton will be by his son Clint's side tonight when he fronts the NRL judiciary on a striking charge. Tony Peters joins us, and Tony, despite his father's hopes, it seems Clint Newton is facing a lengthy time out.
Yeah, certainly looks that way, Ryan. Of course, he arrived here about an hour ago here at the NRL to, of course, face the NRL judiciary at 6 o'clock tonight. Earlier today, he was at his lawyer's office along with his father, Jack Newton, planning their strategy tonight. And, of course, they've since decided that they are, in fact, going to plead guilty, Ryan. He's facing anywhere between 6 and 16 weeks, according to most people, for striking the Dragons prop Ashton Sims last Friday night. A shoulder charge gone wrong is how they're going to voice it up here tonight. Now, it's attracted, of course, an awful lot of publicity with comparisons being made to other players like Danny Williams and Greg Bird, who also both got long suspension. Newton has shown contrition. It's his first charge. Sims, however, did recover and play the game later in that particular match. And, of course, there's real concern about the outcome.
In some quarters, he's been crucified. And, I don't think it's fair. He's made one ill judgment in what we consider to be a tackle and in his career, and some people want to hang him up for it. He knows how to defend himself. He doesn't have to put cheap shots on blokes. He never has, and I've been watching him play since he was 13, and he's never been a dirty player.
It's going to be a long night at the judiciary with Newcastle's Clint Newton and the West Tigers' Bryce Gibbs fighting for their immediate playing futures. Both are in trouble for what they say are shoulder charges gone wrong. But their arguments aren't expected to carry much sway with the tribunal.
Newton arrived for the hearing unsure of how long he'll be out of the game, but the Knights' back rower can expect a suspension of between 10 and 16 weeks. Newton is pleading guilty to striking the Dragons' Ashton Sims, but he'll argue it was a shoulder charge that went wrong. With so little room for error with the tackle, the question is, should it be banned?
I just think it's a poor way to tackle. Yeah, I mean, I haven't... For every shoulder charge that people do, I don't often see the bloke end up on the ground.
Brown says it's the same with spear tackles that are outlawed. The shoulder charge can be dangerous.
We don't try to not do it because we think it's dangerous, I suppose, but if it does sort of get mistimed or misjudged, well, it could be dangerous.
Later tonight, West Tigers' Bryce Gibbs' defence will be the same as Newton's. For one of the game's former tough men, the shoulder charge should be accepted as part of rugby league.
The big men coming together is probably the very essence of rugby league, and shoulder charging is a part of that.
And judgment time for Clint Newton.
Newcastle's Clint Newton has already pleaded guilty before he fronts the NRL judiciary tonight over an elbow to the head of Dragons prop Ashton Sims. Newton's facing a long suspension, but his family fears he's been unfairly labelled a thug.
Golf great Jack Newton led the way as son Clint came to Sydney early to meet with his legal team. He'll tell the judiciary the elbow which flattened Ashton Sims was simply a shoulder charge gone wrong.
In some quarters he's been crucified and, I don't think it's fair.
Despite a previously clean record, the Newtons fear Clint will be made a scapegoat as the code continues its crackdown on foul play ahead of the finals.
It looks bad and we all know that. It's had a lot of publicity and we're just hoping that we get a fair shake of the sausage, so to speak.
Clint's shown genuine contrition and I'm sure that the judiciary will deal with that appropriately.
Newcastle's Clint Newton banned for 12 matches.
Very disappointed.
It's all over for sure for Knights prop Clint Newton. Despite support from his father Jack, he's been outed for 12 weeks for his elbow on Dragons forward Ashton Sims.
Mate, obviously very disappointed about the outcome and no further comment, thanks.
Newton won't play again until round 10 next year. Tony Peters, 10 News.
Also, Clint Newton given plenty of time to think about his career. In rugby league, the Roosters' Luke Ricketson has re-signed for one more season with the competition leaders. Meantime, Newcastle may appeal against Clint Newton's 12-week ban for striking, which will keep him sidelined until May next year.
Setting off for tomorrow night's must-win match against the Bulldogs, no sign of Clint Newton, but Newcastle may contest his 12-week ban.
There may be some grounds for appeal, but we'll, you know, take some advice on that before we go down that path. But I think Clint would be obviously disappointed, and he's going to miss a fair chunk of next year.
More disappointment at the judiciary. Beside his son, father and former golfing great Jack Newton appearing as a character witness. Newton's defence team argued his hit on the Dragons' Ashton Sims was a shoulder charge gone wrong. Despite pleading guilty to striking and a previously clean record, Clint's 12-week ban left Jack too angry for words. His son, visibly upset.
Obviously very disappointed about the outcome and no further comment.
Now look, we've got a special guest host tonight, but next week a specialist guest host. Here she is.
A specialist.
Miss Universe, Jennifer Hawkins. What is doing there? Something. She's a local Newcastle girl, of course, and she will be sitting on this panel next week.
You must. Daddy, I'm excited. You won't believe it. Next week, she's coming back home to Newcastle. Yep. They've made street signs for her. When she goes to the football against the Tigers in round 26, she's got an entourage of 10. It's just going to be huge. She's a dead set legend.
Now, I've got to say, it's been a tough 6 months for Clint Newton. I mean, we're going to talk about it a little later, special, which I didn't think was fair. But, I mean, 6 months ago, he went out with Jennifer Hawkins and he broke it off because he wanted to concentrate in his footy, and he just got 12 weeks. And now she's Miss Universe. So, Jennifer, give the man a call. I mean, please, call him. He's available.
And Newcastle to appeal the 12-week ban handed to forward Clint Newton.
About the outcome and...
Newcastle forward Clint Newton will seek leave to appeal his 12-week suspension handed down this week by the NRL judiciary. Steve Hart joins us from Telstra Stadium. Steve, the Knights are preparing for a very big game there later against the Bulldogs. How will this affect their preparation?
Well, Bill, it shouldn't affect their preparation at all, according to coach Michael Hagan. He's been drilling into his side all week the importance of this game. There's no doubt they've had a few distractions already throughout the year with injuries and whatnot, and he's just said that this is another one that they're going to have to come to terms with. They've got to beat the Dogs. What they can draw on is the big win last time these two teams met back in round 9, a 32-6 to win it was then to Newcastle, so they can draw on that fact. They've also in pretty good form. A narrow loss last week to the Dragons with 12 men for most of the game, and of course they're getting Steve Simpson back this weekend with from his jaw injury. Well, the big thing is, though, it's going to be an against-all-odds win if Newcastle are to do it. And, of course, the Bulldogs, they're fired up after last week's loss to Melbourne, and they've got that minor premiership in sight. So can Newcastle win? Well, they certainly think they can beat them.
Yeah, we're aware how good a side the Bulldogs are. Oh, they're definitely beatable. I mean, we beat them early in the year, and they showed last week the Storm knocked them off. So.
Ken Sutcliffe is out at Telstra Stadium tonight where the Bulldogs take on the Knights.
Jim, it's Newcastle's last chance to make the finals. Friday night football here at Telstra Stadium tonight features the Bulldogs at home to a desperate Newcastle. The last time these two sides met, the Knights scored an impressive 26-point win over the Dogs. But if they lose tonight, Newcastle will miss the finals for the first time since 1996.
And the Knights struggle to stay alive.
Newcastle's Clint Newton will seek leave to appeal his 12-week suspension for striking. His teammates face the Bulldogs tonight and must win to keep their finals hopes alive.
Down but not out, the Knights at least have a mental advantage tonight, one of only five teams to have beaten the Bulldogs this year.
They're going to come out pretty pumped. They'd be confident too. They beat us at Marathon this year quite convincingly.
Newcastle's enforcer Steve Simpson will return 3 weeks early from a fractured jaw to make sure his Knights win.
They want to win their last two games and have every shot to play in the semis too, so they've got a lot to play for.
The Bulldogs have a lot to play for also after an upset loss to Melbourne last week. If they lose tonight, they can kiss the minor premiership goodbye.
If we lose once, we don't lose twice in a row.
Well, the Newcastle coach, Michael Hagan, might have an opinion on that. Matthew Johns is with him right now.
Yeah, there's no injuries report from either room. I'm in the sheds now with Michael Hagan. And Hayes, what about this injury count for your boys? Have you ever seen anything like it?
No, it's certainly at its worst it's ever been. And, that's no excuse for obviously conceding 50 points, but it was a pretty tough week for the club on the back of obviously Clint Newton getting suspended for a number of weeks, and I think we had three players withdraw in the last 24 hours and with serious injuries. I think we've got 10 or 12 first grade players that have been ruled out for the year, so it's been a pretty tough couple of weeks for the club.
Now, big week next week for the club against the Tigers. There's the Alamut Marne Shield is competing for, so I'd like to finish on a high note there.
Yeah, I guess you know, we've still got probably three or four players that played with injury today that wouldn't have played, apart from the fact that it's real dire straits at the moment. Hopefully they'll recover in time and we'll get them get 80 minutes of football out of them next week.
All right, Michael Hagan there.
To rugby league now, and the Bulldogs might be playing it cool, but everyone else is talking them up for the finals, including the coach of their latest victims. Newcastle overwhelmed 52-6, ending a terrible week punctuated by injuries and the dramatic 12-week suspension of Clint Newton. They won't be in the finals.
The Dogs aren't about to let anything get in their way. Their grand final charge has begun in earnest. Newcastle and Robbie O'Davis last night providing little more than a speed bump for the blue and white juggernaut.
Robbie O'Davis has gone for him, but O'Mealy has just shoved him out of the road.
O'Mealy scored a double, bringing this from his coach.
Anytime Shrek gets two in the first 30 minutes, you've got to be starting to wonder what's going on.
Andrew Ryan also crossed twice in what was a night out for the forwards, scoring six of the Dogs' eight tries.
Ryan has run through a huge gap.
And they say the best is yet to come.
There's always a negative. I think the defence, our speed of the line was still a bit off, but hopefully we can improve next week versus the Warriors.
Newcastle completely blown away in the first half, 34-0 down by the break. The Knights coach Michael Hagan, the week has been one of the toughest of his career.
Would be the most disrupted week I can remember in the 4 years I've been here.
The Knights emerged from the break keen to salvage some pride for a season lost. Halfback Steve Witt crossing, but that was as good as it got.
Yeah, very disappointing at the moment, but no, we'll bounce back and we're at home for the final round, and five players that are playing with us now won't be there next year.
While for the Dogs, the good news just keeps rolling on. Few injuries and quality depth. Young back rower Rennie Matua, a late starter for Dennis Scott, chipping in with a try and is hungry for more.
Oh, definitely, yeah. It'd be nice to score a try in the grand final.
You know, I think they'd be disappointed if they didn't figure in the grand final on the way in which they're playing.
But for the team that sits on top of the ladder, at least until the Roosters play the Warriors tomorrow, the grand final is far from a done deal.
It's probably easier for an outsider to say that, but I think there's a lot of hard work to be done to get there. And as long as we keep a good level head and keep playing some good football, hopefully we're a good chance of getting there.
Oh, and the Dogs' backs only added two tries last night. Rathan Astor at his brilliant best, and winger Matt Utai the other. The Roosters are on notice.
I think that loss down against the Storm last weekend did them the world of good. They probably didn't need to be beaten, but I think it just a bit of a reality check for them, and they just bounced back on Friday night and give it to the Knights again.
Who again were without a stack of players. They had Steve Simpson return, but they didn't ever really look like they were in the contest. And I've got to say, I know that Danny probably wouldn't do this, but if I was Michael Hagan, I'd have to seriously consider saying to Danny Medeiros next week, look, go away on holidays. Yeah. You can't do any more. I know that he's carrying a foot injury and has to get, he'll want to be there, but he's got every right to say, look, you've done enough. Go and get some sun.
I think the Knights have got some problems to address. I mean, in past years, over the last decade, the Knights have been very, very strong from the juniors right through to the first grade side. But in the last two or three years, the alarming drop-off in talent and success in the lower grades has been a concern for me, because they're a team that rely upon junior development. They don't go out and buy a lot of star players. And their lower grades have been very poor for a couple of years. I think the club has lost the stigma about its toughness. I think it's lost the stigma about its ability to play the full 80 minutes each week. They've got a champion player in Andrew Johns, who I think makes a lot of other players look better. And I think that they're in for their most important off-season for a long, long time. Michael Hagan hasn't got time to go on holidays this year. He's got a lot of work to do with that club to get themselves back to where they are, because they've lost some key personnel in Tahu and Kennedy. They're leaving the club. Johns is coming back from an injury. They've got a lot of work to do, the Knights, or I fear for what may be ahead for them.
Well, Paul Harrigan, our good friend, of course, he's on the Newcastle board. He's well aware of that. I've spoken to the Chief, and so have you, Peter, about things that he has to address, and he's putting things into motion as we speak about setting up plans for the future.
What about next week, Robbie? Going to be an emotional day?
It will be. A bit
I think I was just talking about a bit tonight was just trying to get through this game leading into next week because it is an important part of my life is that last game. So I got through it injury free. So I'm looking forward to it.
Benzie, have you ever seen the club hit by injuries as bad as this?
No, it's had one of those years. It's pretty hard to put a finger on it, but just playing without confidence and I don't know, we just kept seeming to pick up injuries. We've lost four or five players in the last 48 hours. Couple of neck braces, it's amazing. But in saying that, tonight we just lost our way a bit and don't want to make excuses for injuries, but see what we can come up with next week.
It's up at Newcastle. Emotional farewells will be planned next Saturday night when they take on the Tigers. It's a 5:30 game, and you've got the grand final heroes, the likes of Ben Kennedy, Robbie O'Davis, last game for the Knights. Matty Parsons, who's missed some football lately. Spoke to Matty Parsons this morning. He's been struggling with a bad cork, has missed some football recently. He said he's a definite starter for next Saturday night, and we wish him well. His final game of rugby league.
We have got Miss Universe Jennifer Hawkins.
Look at Hamilton.
Now, look, Reggie, the Olympians arrived home yesterday and what a great job they did. I think 17 gold medals. And Reggie Reagan was out at the airport,
yeah,
I believe.
Yeah, look, they arrived at 6:45 in the morning. Reggie just left the early opener and got there to welcome them home, Fat.
Well, he welcomed the athletes, but he also caught up with both John Howard and Mark Latham.
Hey, look what the cat dragged in.
Hey, good to see you,
Mark Latham.
Were you in the Olympics? Should have been.
Oh, mate, in the real Olympics. Hey, that's it. Where's that little garden gnome?
Who are you talking about?
You know what I'm talking about. Howard the
coward.
Oh,
the other bloke.
The coward.
Upstairs.
Get in. Don't get in. I'd like to see that, eh? Just let me loose on him for 1 minute. Can you do that later? Oh, hey, Koshy, how you going, champ? Where's Lima? Hey, Mark. Mate, they reckon he's a shirt lifter. My thoughts exactly. Go on, stop kissing babies, you old shagger.
Hello. Hi. Are you a softballer too?
Yes, I am.
And I'm her husband. I'm her husband, John.
Oh, how are you?
How are you, mate?
I'll tell you what.
I believe Reggie had a big night on the KB as well.
He had a big night the night before. And just for the record, I think he was wearing Brut, by the way. Brut 33, sir.
First week he
looks. Oh, he's an 80s man.
Well, I tell you what, some of That's Tops, and got a very, very special That's Tops. I remember when this announcement was made, I nearly jumped out of my seat. Have a look at this one.
And the winner, Universe 2004, Australia!
Congratulations, ladies and gentlemen, the new Miss Universe!
The Thunder from Down Under!
Newcastle is home of Miss Universe, and she's here right now. Give her a big round of applause, Jennifer Hawkins!
Jennifer.
Thank you.
It's an honour to have you on.
Thank you.
Be a buzz the last, few months for you, a couple of months.
Yeah, I haven't been home in 4 months, so I'm so ecstatic to be home. And, you know, I'm going to be back in Newcastle tomorrow and get to go to a footy game. And it's just great to be on here tonight.
What's good about coming home?
Just the people and seeing my mates, getting to go out to the nightclubs and, you know, the good old Aussie people.
So tell us what's been going on. Who have you met? What's the Trumpster like? Donald Trump? What about his hair?
Because I'm thinking of getting the brush over.
Oh, really?
Yeah. For all that money, you think you're going to do some plug job. Is it real hair?
Yeah, it is, actually. Honestly. I think it's just really brush forward and brush back.
He's watching, by the way.
Oh, g'day, Donald. Good
hey,
to
boss.
See you. Who else you met? You met any stars over there?
I did meet Richard Gere, and he was quite charming. He was nice. There's a couple other people, but I don't want to go through it all. But, yeah, it's been an amazing experience. So.
Do you ever look around you and just think, like, 5 or 6 months ago, I was there, and now on here, like how
on the footy show, you mean?
Exactly. Yeah. You're probably thinking
that. I'm inspired to be here, you know, on the footy show. No, I'm really happy to be here tonight, actually. But yeah, it's just amazing. Like I didn't think I'd be doing this at 20. So, I'm loving it, though. Absolutely. It's fun.
Life is good.
And what about the footy on Saturday? Are you looking forward to going back and watch a good old Knights game?
Definitely. Yeah, it'll be great. Rock up there. And I wanted to sit on the hill, but can't. I'll
a little
be
bit
the...
different. Yeah, I mean, you want to ride your 10 with you, it'll be a bit hard on the hill.
Have you got a favourite Knights player? A former Knights player? Or... I mean, not me.
Maybe, no, I like them all. They're all my mates.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah, cool. Since you're Miss Universe, have you had any marriage proposals?
There has been a couple, actually, on the email, because I've got, like, a little email thing. But, I mean, just
so you got them, then?
Is that you?
Well, Jennifer, what about your boyfriend? It must be hard on him. He must be doing a bit tough.
Oh, not really. I think, you know...
4 months away is a long time.
Well, especially if you put it that way. No, you know, we're young and, you know, we're going along with things and...
Oh, that's right.
He's not doing it tough.
You've got pretty good bragging rights down at the local, I'll tell you.
The camp so far, it's been good. What do you think the best bit has been?
Medical. I like the medical. When everyone's walking around their underpants, in a strange sort of way, it makes me feel like a man.
What should I talk to Wayne about? Because he doesn't like talking about footy.
His long back, his big ears, his long neck. Why, just ask, say, Wayne, why do you never smile? Just ask him something like
that. He always smiles at me.
Oh. I wonder why.
Sorry,
I thought you'd make him smile.
There you go.
Now, look, we saw a little bit of Reggie out at the airport. Of course, he was there to greet all the Olympians. Here's Reggie's report.
I was all in that creepy now.
Oh, there he is, the garden name. On your Latho. On your Thorby. On your son. On your Yana. How are you, darling? Call me, the Pommy bloke. That fellow by Redgrave. He described you as the best rower of all time. How do you feel about that?
Well, I actually didn't realise he'd said that, but he's a bloody good judge, isn't he?
He is. He reckons you're a good sort as well. Good on you, son.
Cheers, mate.
Done us proud again.
Thanks.
How's it feel, mate, to be back home?
It's great to be home. Very glad. See guys like you, the larrikins. It's good to see.
Larrikins?
Yeah, larrikins, mate.
Good old Aussie larrikins.
That's all right.
Thorby, shall I be so bold? Can I have a hug, mate?
All right, you can have a hug.
Come here, old son, you old shaggy old nut. Come here. God, Mr. Navy. How do you describe the feeling coming home and seeing me just standing there?
Yeah, I saw you doing your dancing and stuff out there. Somebody was out, Reggie.
You girls got boyfriends?
Nah, both single, yeah.
Looking for a boyfriend?
Maybe.
When you get out the court, how do you trash talk?
What sort of trash? No, well, the problem was I had a crack at Tim Duncan. I said a couple of words to him and he looked at me and he goes, I don't know what you're saying.
Oh, really?
Doesn't understand good Aussie talk.
Like, get f***ed. What about Jason Stevens? Anything there?
We're just good friends.
Just good friends. Oh, hang on. Hey, get to my...
Just good friends. I'm waiting for you.
I'll give you a warning. 10 years will be like a fire hydrant going off, OK? Careful, what's the underbelly? Before you went away to the games, I'll give you a call and I said, Matty, when you get over there, son, you just go hard, go hard, go hard. What did you do?
I went hard, mate.
If the Netherlands had beat us, it would have been a travesty of justice and we'd have had to give 10 medals to their goalie and one to the Netherlands.
Still on the prescription drugs, Laurie?
Oh, how's that
time? How's that bloody knee?
Yeah, it's coping, slowly.
Danker up, emu oil.
Very good shit.
I suppose just to say thank you to Australia for supporting us all the way.
See, well, you can start by thanking me. I'm your number one supporter, okay? You're one of those, and one for you too. Hey?
Got you up for a tree.
Thanks, mate.
I'll tell you what, you were rooted after your swim.
Oh, mate, I was gone. I gave it everything.
Mate, it was like Reggie Boy leaving the early open. I just like, gone like that.
Oh, mate, I was thinking of you the whole time. That's what got me by.
You were just thinking, mate.
I just thought, what would Reggie do right now? What would Reggie do in this last 100 metres? And I went with it. And look what happened.
The thousand nations kiss our beauty, rich and rare. You never get sick of it, do you?
No.
That's Australia for you, little f***ing beauty.
Well, honestly, To get back on Australian soil was fantastic, but it must have been a bonus to see the great Reg Regan there waiting for you.
We could see him on the plane.
Out of the window.
Doing stands. We're like, oh, he's yes, Reg Regan made it.
Wouldn't have been the same without him, I think.
Yeah, it's just about time to wrap up the show tonight, but Jennifer Hawkins, you had you went to a shopping centre today and something happened. There was a bit of drama. What happened?
Yeah, I was walking out in a Bora Bora dress and the bottom actually came off.
Of your dress?
Yeah.
It just fell off?
No, I'm serious, and it was so embarrassing, but, you know, I just thought I'd get it out in the open, and I know it's going to be on the news tonight, so just a pity I wasn't wearing better panties.
So what are you talking right off?
Yeah.
Sure, okay.
And you had some panties on, though?
Yes.
Oh, that's good news. That's
excellent. Yes.
All right, well,
footy show.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
All right, excellent.
Keep your head up, Jen. Nothing. I'm easily embarrassed myself. Man.
Now, Jennifer's appearing, of course, courtesy of Westfield at Westfield Katara. That's in Newcastle. That is tomorrow, Friday, September the 3rd, 1:30 till 2. And the next Thursday, September the 9th, between 6:30 and 7:30 at Westfield Southland in Melbourne. Members of the general public, welcome to go along. Have a chat. She's a lovely young lady.
And Jennifer,
because she's so nice.
And just before we go, it's the first time you're coming back to Newcastle tomorrow, isn't it?
Tomorrow, yeah.
And,
I'm excited.
And on Saturday will be the first time Newcastle people, because the Knights game against the Tigers,
yes,
we get a chance to show how proud we are. She's just amazing.
Jennifer, on behalf of the Footy Show.
Thank you.
Miss Universe, been very privileged and proud to have you on the show. Thanks very
so
much.
Incredible.
Thanks, Chief. Thanks, Falcon. Guys. Thanks, Matty Johns. Thanks, Snoopy. That's it for tonight. See you next week on the Footy Show. Bye for now.
A catwalk calamity leaves our Miss Universe unexpectedly exposed.
From National 9 News, this is Nightline with Hugh Remington.
Good evening. That moment of universal embarrassment a little later.
OK, here it is. I know it's the story you've been waiting for. Yes, Miss Universe is back in town. And yes, she's hard to miss. In an embarrassing mishap, one of Jennifer Hawkins' first public appearances revealed a whole lot more than she might have planned for.
On stage at a Sydney shopping centre, it was, well, one of those moments. Today, the aftermath.
No, I wish I did wear designer pants underneath. I could have at least, you know, given someone a nice look. They're just Bonsies. Bonds. No, I didn't know what to do. I don't think anyone knows what to do in that situation. And when I was on stage, the first thing that just went through my mind, I'm just like, oh my God, what are people going to say tomorrow?
Maybe it swelled crowds at her Newcastle welcome home. There she was, brave as could be, sporting a bikini very tightly. The crowd still distracted by her cheeky moment.
Oh my God.
Because I was like speechless, as well as I could. It was unbelievable. I just looked at her and like, shit. That's pretty good, that.
I thought it was fantastic. I'm waiting for another one today.
A girl's never minded a little flattery.
Yeah, she's nice, but...
Oh, thank you. I exercise a lot, so I don't know. Thank you very much, but...
Others applauded her use of, shall we say, bottom etiquette.
Excellent. Straight away with the hands.
And it didn't change what the little fans think.
Oh, I just love her.
Jennifer's welcome home wish is simple. She just wants to eat mum's bolognese. But life for this former Newcastle girl is going to be anything but suburban. Will be a life full of public appearances, and she promises to take a safety pin to all of them. And as for her unlucky and now infamous duds...
I'm chucking them, I'm burning them, I'm serious.
Jacinta Hocking, 10 News.
Oh, she's such a sweetie. Sport is X with Ryan Phelan. Now you're concentrating now, aren't you?
Yes.
Focus.
Yeah. Now, a big day here in Newcastle, of course, their last home game of the season, and there have been plenty of old Newcastle players from different eras here today to celebrate this last game of the 2004 season. And one of them joins us. In fact, it's the club record holder for most games for the Newcastle Knights. Tony Butterfield is with us here on Super Saturday. Thanks for your time, Tony, and a bit of a celebration here today, isn't it?
It is. It's traditionally the old boys' day. We all get together and celebrate the good times from the past and tell a few long yarns, but a big day. It's a reasonable crowd starting to build up, and the Knights are confident.
Unfortunately, Tony, it does look as though it will be the Knights' last game of the 2004 season. It's been a season crueled by injury, really, hasn't it?
It has. Injury has taken its toll on many clubs, but no more so than Newcastle, I would have thought. But you need to be philosophical. This is a very tough game, and the players are just enjoying their last game of the year, and probably the respite in the build-up for next season.
Yeah, talking about the build-up for next season, are you happy with the players that the club's bought, and do you believe that if you get a fair share of luck with injuries, then you'll be part of the semi-finals for next year?
Well, I think the club can only spend within the cap, and they've been limited there, and they've lost a number of good names, so certainly there'll be a focus on a number of individuals to really step up and mature over the course of the off-season. So a real challenge for the Knights and other teams that have recruited to try and rebuild for next season.
When you talk Newcastle Knights, obviously you talk Andrew Johns, and he suffered that unfortunate knee problem at the start of the year. Mm. Have you spoken to Andrew, and how's the leg coming along, and has there been any complications since the operation?
No, Andrew's fine. He's recovered well. He's had the best of care, and he's moving around quite freely at the moment, and really looking forward to an off-season. So that buoys the club's spirits in terms of certainly their management, in terms of how they build for next year. And if Andrew's on deck, things start to move along well, and certainly engenders a confidence across the team.
Now, Tony, while we're talking about great clubmen for the Newcastle Knights, of course, one of them bows out today. Robbie O'Davis has played just six games less for the Knights than you played in your career. He has been a terrific player for Newcastle, hasn't he?
Oh, tremendous. Laurie would know, and many people out there listening and watching will have enjoyed the exploits of Robbie O'Davis over the last 12 seasons. He's been a tremendous performer. He's got the flair and the style. He's a past Clive Churchill medal winner in the 97 grand final, and a fitting send-off tonight. Probably not on his terms, as has been made public, but in any event, people need to move on, and Robbie's done a tremendous job. And when yarns will be spun in years to come, there will be yarns told about Robbie O'Davis.
And have you had a chance to speak to Robbie O this week?
Yeah, I've spoken to him over the last couple of weeks, and he was just starting to lose focus a little bit. There was probably a little bit going on in the media, and I encouraged him to enjoy the last time, because as you and I would know, Laurie, you're retired for a long time, and enjoy your time, and try and go out as positive as you can.
Yeah, that's certainly correct. And while we're talking about blokes that are retiring at the end of the year, and Robbie O'Davis has certainly given great service to the Newcastle Football Club, Matt Parsons, the big front rower, the guy that really dominated Parramatta in that 2001 grand final, he's decided to hang up his boots again. A massive loss for the club, and certainly been a great club man as well.
Well, he is. He's a very likeable guy, somebody that I had a great friendship with. I had one season, luckily enough, and he's toiled very well for the last five or six seasons with the Knights, and is a real crowd favourite here. And he'll be missed. He's moving up to play with a few mates in the Tamworth area, so he'll still be going around. But Ben Kennedy moving on to Mana Tahu, and Russell Richardson, erstwhile Cronulla lad, has moved to Newcastle. He'll be retiring tonight also. So a little bit of nostalgia here tonight, but always a great occasion for the last game.
You mentioned some of those great names moving on from the Newcastle Knights, including Tamana Tahu and Ben Kennedy. And it's 2005 is a real look into the future, isn't it, as to what lays before the Newcastle Knights. Got a taste of it this year with Andrew Johns out of action, and I suppose we'll see what the next stage for the club is after such a successful run with something like 10 seasons in a row being in the finals.
Well, absolutely. It becomes part of the culture, and unfortunately on this occasion things conspired for the club, injuries included, but all clubs are affected in that regard. I think certainly with 600 plus points scored against them over the season, they need to focus on defence, and they're not Robinson Crusoe in that regard. So a real big off-season for all clubs that didn't make the cut this year, but hope springs eternal and everybody will move forward and try and do their best next year.
Yeah, obviously there's plenty of motivation for both teams. The Newcastle side want to send out a few players on a winning note, and the West Tigers, of course, playing for that position in the top eight. How do you see the game panning out this evening?
Well, there's certainly been some media through the week with Tim Sheens ensuring his players are focused, and with a little bit of boxing work, etc. I've no doubt, not that I've seen the Newcastle guys go around, but I've no doubt the Newcastle guys are just as focused. I think it'll be a tough game. The Balmain guys are playing for their season and for their first entry into the semi-finals for quite some time. So I'm sure they'll be motivated, but Newcastle just as motivated in front of a home crowd in their last game. So should be a tough game.
Tony, thanks for your time. We do appreciate it, and good luck to your Newcastle Knights tonight.
Pleasure. Thanks, guys.
Tony Butterfield there, of course, a proud Newcastle man and now the president of the Rugby League Professionals Association. We will take a break here on Super Saturday, but come back to take a look at the remaining games in round 26.
Chance again now. It goes away to Kurt Gidley.
That was Perry. This is Gidley. Gidley slides one out the back. David Siege. They've got numbers if they keep it in the hands. Great ball. Kurt to Matthew Gidley. Try.
Ask and you shall receive. Laurie Daly, there is Jennifer Hawkins, Miss Universe, the former Newcastle Knights cheerleader, doing a lap of the oval here, and the fans are giving her quite a welcome as well.
Well, why wouldn't they? She's a local product. She enjoys the Newcastle Knights Football Club, an ex-cheerleader for the club, and they are welcoming her here tonight. I mean,
little wave right there for you, Laurie.
What more can you say?
A little wave right there for you, mate.
Oh, thank you, mate. You reckon she's seen us on TV before?
I think she might have, Laurie. She's a big fan of yours, I do believe.
Oh, yeah. Apparently she emailed the show the other night to tell her.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, I'll take a look at the computer when I get back to work on Monday morning. Now, of course, she's here hoping to see the Newcastle Knights beat the Tigers. If that scenario comes true, then the Sharks and the Raiders will be very excited about what they faced later tonight, of course. But the Knights can be very tough to beat here in their last home game of seasons. As the graphic will tell you, when they've played their last home game of the season, they've won 3 out of 4 on average. And you can see 12 wins, 4 losses in their last minor premiership game of every season since they've come, of course, into the competition back in 1988.
Well, the club's built on mateship, it's built on courage, it's built on aggression and camaraderie, and they do have the old boys club here on every last game, and that's one of the reasons why I think the Newcastle Knights always produce on the last game of the year. I mean, it's something special. Their club has really been a forward-thinking club. I mean, they've produced some of the best players in the game, and they get behind their old boys. Their old boys are here to try and, you know, say, you know, welcome and follow the blokes that are finishing at the end of the year through. And I think if they can do that tonight, they probably inspire the Knights to a victory.
Let's hear from their coach now. Michael Hagan is with Russell Fairfax.
Michael, a game you still want to win, but you must deny West Tigers some confidence, and that means a good start.
Yeah, it does, and I think you know, they've got a lot to play for this afternoon, and coming off a poor performance last weekend like we are. So I think both teams will be pretty determined this afternoon to turn that around.
A strange feeling for you. First time the Knights have missed the semis while you've been here, but still plenty to play for, I guess, and you're farewelling a number of players.
Yeah, we are. I think you know, it's been a tough year for us in a lot of ways, but we'd love to finish on a good note. Obviously, Ben Kennedy, Robbie O'Davis, Matt Parsons have all served the club extremely well for a long time, and I'm sure the players feel they'd like to send them off in the right manner.
And what are you going to do with yourself in the off-season?
Put the feet up for a little while, but I guess there's a bit to do before you can do that, and as I said, it's been a tough year. We need to review a few things and get a few healthy troops back on the deck.
Thanks for the year, Mike.
Thank you.
Well, if one of the more incredible things you've ever seen in football comes true tonight, the off-season may have to be put back a week for the Newcastle Knights. If they win by 49+, I know it's far-fetched, the Tigers will have then a worse for and against than this particular side, the Newcastle Knights. Newcastle are a minuscule chance of still figuring in week one of the finals.
Yeah, but they've still got a strong outfit. You look at their forward pack, and I think they'll be planning an aggressive assault on the West Tigers tonight. 5 of those starting players played in the 2001 premiership winning team, so there's a lot of experience in the forward pack. I think they expect the tough, tight opening to the game. They've gone with their best players. I think it'll be very physical in the early exchanges. And they have got some creative halves. They've got some outside backs who can take the most of their opportunities. And Robbie O'Davis also looking for a big game. They might produce an upset.
It's time for the toss now. Our referee for this big game is Tim Mander. And he's with the captains Danny Medeiros and Darren Center.
Okay, Dan, onside toss. Heads.
Answer tails.
Dan, what do you want to do, mate?
Kick off.
You'll kick off? Which way, Dan? Darren?
We'll run right to left.
You'll run right to left, so you're kicking off that way. Okay, all the best.
Well, Danny Medeiros, all the talk this week that you wouldn't play. You've just come out of hospital. How is the foot? You ready to go?
Yeah, no, that was obviously, I just was in hospital just to fast track a few antibiotics. So it's just got infected again, and you know, there's 80 minutes to go, and hopefully we can finish on a good note.
Chance to spoil their party as well as say goodbye to, you know, Tahu, Kennedy, Robbie O, just to mention a couple.
Yeah, it's a big day for us, and also we've got the old boys here, and we've got a lot of other memories. We've got Wal Bentley, our boxing trainer. He's calling it quits. So, you know, there's a lot of things that mean a lot to a lot of people tonight, so hopefully we can go on a good note.
Certainly one of those will be repaying the fans' faith. Good luck.
Thanks for us.
It is some sort of effort by Danny Medeiros to be available for this game after being in hospital with an infected toe once again this week.
Great player, great leader, inspirational player, Danny Medeiros. He's shown his courage for the last couple of seasons, plays with injury, and when he plays with injury, he always plays to the best of his ability.
Okay, make sure you stay with us because the Tigers looking for a berth in the finals for the very first time if they can beat the Newcastle Knights here on Super Saturday. That game's coming up next.
And the game will end with Robbie O'Davis in possession of the ball. That'll do us. He's got one more war wound to take into retirement. But he won't care because his Knights have finished the season yet again as winners here in Newcastle. They've beaten the Tigers 26 points to 16. So eighth spot. It is up for grabs. The Sharks are a chance against the Cowboys. Likewise, the Raiders against the Rabbitohs in Canberra. And you'll see both games, of course, live after this here on Fox Sports. Matt Parsons. What a way to round out his career. They've beaten the Tigers by 10. And make sure you stay with us because in a moment, on the other side of the break, we'll take you to Townsville to see that game between the Sharks and the Cowboys. And we will also at the same time on the main event, Channel 3, have the Raiders and the Rabbitohs. Before that though, let's go downstairs to Russell.
Robbie O'Davis, after 12 seasons and 233 games here, it's all over, mate.
Yeah, Russell, mate, it's, what can I say? Finishing, mate, unbelievable. That's all I can say. These people, this team, a win. It's just, I've got no words for it other than I'm the most proudest person in the world right now. And wouldn't be at any other place.
There's no doubt all the fans want to say thank you, Robbie. It's been a fantastic career. Get your nasty knock you've got there. How's the head?
Mate, that's another note. Don't worry about things like that. That's just all part of the game. I'm just glad the boys helped me get a win. I mean, last game. Unbelievable.
Where to from here?
Pub.
Enjoy yourself, Robbie. Thank you.
Robbie O'Davis, as you can understand, it started with plenty of emotion when he ran onto the field. It finished the same way. It's quite a nasty knock he copped on the cheekbone to finish with, and it happened on the last play of the game. The Knights have beaten the Tigers. Robbie O played a very big part. He saved the try by stopping Scott Prince close to the line. And they've beaten West 26 points to 16. The Tigers will now have to wait and see what happens in Townsville and Canberra. It finished up this way. Hall scored two tries. Perry and Kurt Gidley also scored. Kurt Gidley, a perfect night with a boot, 5 from 5. Galea, Centre and Harrison also scored for the Tigers. Hodgson kicked 2 from 3 and Cavell 0 from 1. A chance with a long-range penalty goal. He couldn't find the flags in the air and the Knights went on to win it. The Tigers are shattered for the moment, but they will put their faith in the North Queensland Cowboys and the Rabbitohs. Make sure you watch those games live. We will take a break and the action on Super Saturday will continue right after this.
Last night's big win against Brisbane has seen Penrith wrap up a vital top four spot, but two key players have an anxious week with injuries. In the first of three important games tonight, the Knights and Tigers are 12-all approaching half-time.
In his last game for Newcastle, O'Davis ran on teary-eyed, but within the first couple of minutes, the Tigers were pressing. The try wasn't allowed when replay showed Cavell had knocked on. Then another blow, when centre jolted O'Neill's neck. O'Neill was taken off in a brace, and from the restart, Perry scored his first try of the season in the last round.
Of course, the Knights had a penalty!
The first up from last night's games, we'll look at the Tigers went to Newcastle, looking for a win, Gus, to get into that top eight.
Yeah, well, all eyes were on this game, particularly down in Canberra and up in North Queensland, because the Sharks and the Raiders really needed the Tigers to be beaten, and the Knights did them a good turn. They scored the first try through Josh Perry, but the Tigers hit back with a couple of close-range ones. Galea was able to barge over off an inside pass from Darren Centre, and then Darren Centre himself from dummy half was able to get the Tigers in front at 12-6, and at that stage, the Hearts dropped in Canberra and North Queensland, and the Tigers looked good. But the Knights had plenty to play for. They had a lot of players retiring in this game. Parsons and Robbie O'Davis are going. Ben Kennedy's moving to Manly. And they showed plenty of spirit themselves. O'Davis had one of his stellar performances in both attack and defence. He was absolutely outstanding.
It was vintage O'Davis, you know, from any part of his career. It's probably one of the better games he's ever played, actually, and he finished with in a hail of emotion, and well done.
And this fella, young Bronson Harrison, I think you're going to hear a lot about this kid. He really was damaging last night. He made a lot of little half breaks, scored a vital try at this time, but Simpson back inside to Kurt Gidley, the game is wrapped up. And when desire is equal, I mean, the Tigers had desire about making the eight and the Knights had desire about sending their mates off with a win. When desire is equal, usually talent stands up, and the talent last night from the Knights was very, very good. All their top players played well. Kennedy, Badiris, Simpson, the Gidley boys, O'Davis, they were all terrific.
I tipped the Tigers early in the week, but I went to a function up for the Newcastle Knights during the week. I'd have reserved my judgment until the feel up there, speaking to the guys. Kurt Gidley was at the table, even Matty Parsons, they all sounded very confident because they realised what a big day it was for the club last home game, the old boys' day.
Can I just say this too, and I've whinged about this a lot. The salary cap rules that allows or that makes a bloke like Robbie O'Davis have to leave his club, the only club he's ever played for, his long-serving club, and have to retire when he's still got so much good football to offer is a disgrace. And the owners and the administrators of this game refuse to budge on this issue. When you've got players going to England, you've got Steve Price got to leave the Bulldogs. It's going to happen to Luke Ricketson at the Roosters sometime in the near future. Robbie O'Davis at Newcastle. Players should never have to leave their club for salary cap restrictions.
You solve it by giving bigger concessions.
If the NRL administration hasn't got the foresight to look into it, why don't you and some
they
other
haven't
people
got the
go
motivation. Well,
have you been to them?
1,000 times.
Yeah.
What do they say? They're not listening.
So what do you suggest?
What do you
suggest?
They're not listening.
What do you suggest?
They've got to be concessions.
There's got to be
huge concessions for those players. You get players that have played 10 years, played for their country, played for their state, played 10 years service, only ever played for the one club. I mean, there's only a few of them around. It's not as though you're giving concessions to everyone in the world.
If
the criteria is play for your country, play for your state, play for one club your whole career, play 200 first-grade games, how many people are going to do that? They should be on the books for nothing.
Yep, all right. Gus fired up again by the salary cap. You have nightmares about the salary cap.
I hate it.
Dreams about it.
There should be no salary cap.
It is a problem when you get a side that develops a football team and then gets
and
to the stage where they can't afford to keep
anyway, it. Anyway, Todd Nardi from Newcastle was in the dressing rooms after the game for some interviews.
Special to finish my career here with a lot of players, you know. We've had some great players here and there's still some great players here, so it was great to get a chance to play them. Mate, Danny Badiris came out of hospital this morning to play in the game, you know, and that means a lot to someone like me. There was no reason for Danny to play tonight, but he played and everyone's seen how he went.
I won't have a great memory of our last year. It's been pretty disappointing, mate. We've been knocked about, but they're excuses, you know, and we still had a fairly good team, so we probably should have went better than what we did. But in saying that, mate, it was a terrific crowd. It was packed stadium and, it was very emotional.
A disappointing year from our point of view and very frustrating at times. We probably lost, you know, some games by not many that we thought we should have won, but that's what we've got to accept. And I guess we finished the year with a little bit of credibility. And I mean, the Tigers had a bit to play for, and it was a pretty fair game of football as it turned out.
Yeah, no Robbie Owen, that little spread there, but he's in a special feature piece on some retirees a bit later in the show.
Now, plenty of emotion last night in matches played. We've heard from some of the retiring Newcastle players, but for Robbie O,
The Clive Churchill medal winner from 1997 last night was something really special.
There's no better town I'd rather be in than right here in Newcastle right now. And these people made me the person that I am, and I try to repay them every week by going out the field and knocking myself around and entertaining them, and hopefully I've done that for them over the years, and they repay me by making me walk down the street with my head held high. And I've got to thank so many people for giving me the personality I've got out of this game, and minus the scars, I've had so much fun. Got no regrets, and I've finally left a winner.
Robbie O'Davis.
It was 1989, actually. The Knights were playing Balmain at home. It was a big game for the Knights, and I was sort of just at school myself, and I was sitting behind the post with a couple of mates, and it was the Australian schoolboys game. Australian schoolboys played the English schoolboys, and someone had tipped me off. They said, have a look at the 5'8", Brad Fiddler. And I heard a bit about him, but you don't know, you know, if it's hype or what the rest, but I remember the first time he got the ball, he dead set beat half a dozen blokes, scored a try. Every time he got the ball, he was unstoppable. I remember after the game, I thought to myself, this bloke's going to be one of the immortals.
Tuvey now, looking for Brad Fiddler. And there goes the captain! There goes the captain! Brad Fiddler's in, you little beauty!
Just a special player who, when the things are on the line, I remember playing in a semi-final with him in the World Cup at 95 and extra time against the Kiwis. He dead set won the game for us. Just took him to the line and scored a great try. And he's one of those players had the ability to do that at any level. So he's a true champion.
Well, mate, you know, to us, you know, to come here tonight and pay a tribute, you know, to a bloke who's played for his country, for New South Wales, you know, captain to a grand final win. That, you know, was a pleasure. I mean, the thing about it is about the bloke, he's brave, he's tough, he's so skillful, and, you know, to come here and pay tribute to Craig Gower, it's just an honour.
Brad Fiddler.
Yeah, he's a good player. He's a good player.
Well, one of the great things about the football community is that we do look after our own. And yesterday at Newcastle, there's a man called Walt Bentley who's been a part of the Newcastle club for many years, a trainer, does a lot of their boxing work, is not well. And yesterday the old boys and the Newcastle club paid tribute to their great mate.
A man walking down the middle of these great men is one of the legends of our club. His name is Wally Bentley. He's doing a bit tough at the moment, but I'd like you all to stand and give him a round of applause, because he's one of our club's legends. Wally Bentley.
From tries we go to try savers, and it's an exciting part of the game. A lone defender prevents a four-pointer. Andrew Black rates a Steve Simpson effort to hold up Parramatta's Andrew Ryan in the 2001 Grand Final as one of the biggest plays he's seen. Let's have a look.
Nathan Haymarsh, they're in! Andrew Ryan! Andrew Ryan,
I've got to check.
Subject to video scrutiny.
Well, I think we're all looking at the grounding of the football here. Nathan Hindmarsh getting into dummy half. And another man who played State of Origin this year, Andrew Ryan, runs very good lines. Comes into the gap. Simpson coming across to try and stop him. Does he get the ball down? He has it. He has not got the football down. Unbelievable. Steve Simpson, a try saver.
A couple of field goals now for Luke McDonald. Mark Glanville's snapshot in 1997 for the Knights. What a great rugby league moment is this. Collision, line it up and bang it over. Well done, Mark Glanville.
And Patrick Tedesco has requested Kurt Gidley's golden point effort from this year against the Brisbane Broncos up at Suncorp Stadium.
He gets himself plenty of depth, gets the kick away. Newcastle has won it. Kurt Gidley, he kicked a freaking goal.
The other big league story this weekend surrounded last night's dramatic three-way shootout for the last remaining spot in the top eight. But while Canberra celebrated, both the Sharks and the Tigers said goodbye to 2004.
After 26 rounds, the fate of three teams was riding on one outcome. Newcastle breaking a 12-all deadlock before the Tigers clawed their way back.
And the youngster is over for the Tigers.
But from there it went downhill fast. Hodgson hammered while Richards came within a whisker of scoring. The Tigers out of luck, but a Simpson bust had the Knights celebrating.
Strike a telling blow against the Tigers' finals hopes.
And in his farewell at home, Robbie O'Davis was having a blinder. A try-saving tackle on Prince, then this on Hodgson.
Another blow for the Tigers.
The final tackle providing him with one last war wound after a memorable career.
I've got no words for it other than I'm the most proudest person in the world right now. Wouldn't be at any other place.
Please welcome your host, Warren Smith.
Welcome to the Starship Enterprise. What a setting, what a night, and what a location. It's nice to be back, isn't it, at the Sydney Town Hall once again. Thank you all for being here for what is Rugby League Night of Nights, of course. Laurie Daly there, of course, with Amos Roberts. Now it's time to get to the countdown for this year's Dally M medal. And here are the main rules for the voting system. Voting is on a 3-2-1 basis for each game of the regular season. Players are eligible for points in Origin games if they stood down from their club game in the previous round. And players suspended for any reason will be deducted 3 points for every week of their suspension. They are the rules, and here are the leading vote getters after the first 16 rounds of the Telstra Premiership.
Dally M medal leaders after 16 rounds. From the Brisbane Broncos with 11 points, Darren Lockyer.
Gives it to Lockyer. Last play, Lockyer for the line. The champion reaches out and scores an important try.
From the Penrith Panthers with 11 points, Craig Gower.
Gower from the scrum win, goes straight through them. Tillman's chasing, but they won't catch Gower.
From the Canberra Raiders with 11 points, Mark McClendon.
Comes to McClendon, who shows it. What a move from McClendon, and what a step from Carmichael Hunt.
From the Brisbane Broncos, with 11 points, Shane Webke.
Webke's ready for another, and Webke goes for 15 metres.
From the North Queensland Cowboys, with 12 points, Paul Rauhihi. From the St George Illawarra Dragons with 12 points, Lance Thompson.
Last play, Thompson has a shot at the line. Thompson's got it as well. Lance Thompson.
From the Bulldogs with 13 points, Stephen Price.
There's a good ball lead. Charged out. Here's a chance. He gets the bounce. Will he have the pace? He scores the try.
from the Cronulla Sharks with 16 points, Brett Camorley.
Here's Camorley, dummying, going himself, shrugs away from the Walker tackle to score.
From the Parramatta Eels with 17 points, Nathan Hindmarsh.
Here's Hindmarsh again. Hard to stop, impossible to stop.
From the Newcastle Knights with 18 points, Danny Badiris.
Badiris, up the middle goes Badiris. He's still going. Oh, what a dummy. And Badiris scores under the black dot.
From the Sydney Roosters with 19 points, Brett Finch.
Now Finch looking for a double, and it's all too easy.
That is how they stood after 16 rounds when the voting went underground. And of course, Brett Finch, a leader by one at that stage over Danny Badiris. Now, to take us through the remaining rounds, NRL CEO David Gallop joins us once again to read out the votes tonight here at the Town Hall.
Three players in the top 10 polled votes in round 19. Darren Lockyer from Brisbane against Newcastle, three votes. Craig Gow from Penrith against Canberra, three votes. And Danny Badiris from Newcastle against Brisbane, one vote.
So Danny Badiris closes the gap there now to be within just three votes of Brett Finch after 19 rounds. It's getting a bit interesting at the top there, isn't it? And of course, Craig Gower and Darren Lockyer, each were the big movers there with 3 points each as we once again take a look at our tally. 3 points the gap between Finch and Badiris, two there to Nathan Hindmarsh. And of course, Andrew Ryan also makes his first appearance in the top 10 after grabbing a point against Cronulla.
Round 21. The Rabbitohs were hoping to play the role of spoilers when they hosted the Knights at Aussie Stadium. But Newcastle scored a vital win to remain one of the contenders for the top eight.
Two players in the top 10 polled votes in round 21. Matt Orford from Melbourne against the Roosters, one vote. And Danny Badiris from Newcastle against South Sydney, three votes.
What about that? The Newcastle captain polls three votes. And guess what? Suddenly here we have a tie at the top of the leaderboard after 21 rounds of the count. Danny Badiris, Brett Finch now on 22 each. Paul Rauhihi, of course, there still 3 points behind, remembering three for the major vote-getters in each game. Nathan Hindmarsh, 17. Camorley still 16. And Matt Orford himself has moved into outright sixth place after polling one vote against the Roosters. We'd like to hear more from you Melbourne fans as well for Matty Orford.
Four players in the top 10 polled votes in round 22. Scott Prince from the West Tigers against South Sydney, one vote. Darren Lockyer from Brisbane against the Warriors, two votes. Craig Gow from Penrith against Manly, two votes. And Danny Badiris from Newcastle against Canberra, three votes.
Danny Badiris. Back-to-back three-pointers for the Newcastle Knights, and we do have a new leader in our count. And only two forwards have ever won the Dally M medal. It's a streak that goes back all the way to 1989, when Gavin Miller, in fact, with the Sharks, was the last forward to take out this prestigious award. And Danny Badiris, of course, all this time on, has a chance to break that streak. He leads by three over Brett Finch. Paul Rauhihi is there, still three votes further back in third place on 19. Nathan Hindmarsh is stuck there on 17. Craig Gower, 16 now after picking up votes there in that particular round. Camorley, Lockyer, Orford, Prince and Price at this stage still not out of the reckoning.
Five players in the top 10 polled votes in round 24. Craig Gower from Penrith against North Queensland, three votes. Matt Orford from Melbourne against the Bulldogs, two votes. Nathan Hindmarsh from Parramatta against the Warriors, one vote. Brett Finch from the Roosters against Canberra, one vote. And Danny Badiris from Newcastle against St George Illawarra, two votes.
What a race we have. It's to and fro, isn't it? The challenger comes back with a vote and the leader responds to it. Let's take a look at that leaderboard now with just two rounds remaining in our count. There's rarely been a vote like it in recent times, of course, with Andrew Johns and also Preston Campbell dominating in recent years. But Danny Badiris once again leads Brett Finch by three votes. Nathan Hindmarsh moves to 21. Matt Orford, of course, still there, is out of the running. But anyone of the top three, of course, can still pick up a Dally M medal in 2004. Craig Gower, Paul Rauhihi, Brett Camorley, Darren Lockyer, Scott Prince and Steve Price round out our top 10 as things stand at the moment. Now, of course, we could have a winner in round 25 to present the 2004 Dally M medal. Would you please welcome the Prime Minister of Australia, Mr. John Howard, and the winner of this year's Miss Universe title from Newcastle, Jennifer Hawkins. Jennifer, thank you for being here tonight. Lovely to see you.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
I was in Newcastle calling a game between the Tigers and the Knights on Saturday night, and there you are before the game doing a lap in a convertible car. And I must say, the crowd, the reception they gave you was quite incredible. Did you expect that from the home fans as such?
I didn't expect it, but it was a nice surprise, I'll tell you, when I was driving around and on the converter, which was quite nice. Everyone was giving me a warm welcome, and I appreciated it a lot.
You're still a proud Newcastle girl?
Yeah, definitely. I've been there all for the last 3 days, so I got to have a party and relax with my family.
Now, of course, we're building up through the finals, and when we talk about football teams, we think about strengths and weaknesses and where one team might exploit the other. In the final of the Miss Universe contest, what's your strength? Is it the evening gown? Is it the swimsuit, perhaps?
I don't know. I don't really know. Everyone asks me that, and I'm not really into beauty pageants, so I don't know what I did out there. So I just went out and had a bit of fun, so it worked out well.
Now, of course, you are a well-known former cheer girl for the Newcastle Knights, and attitudes to women in rugby league in 2004 has been a hot topic. I'm sure you would say there is still a place in the game for cheer girls.
Definitely. It gives the game a different edge, and it makes it a bit more fun, and gives the guys in the crowd something to look at, so why not?
Finally, if you were Prime Minister for a day, what would be the first thing you'd do?
Oh, God. I don't know. That's a hard topic. I mean, I'm not a political person, but I think John Howard's doing a great job, and I don't know, I wouldn't change it.
A very diplomatic answer. Perhaps a pay rise for all cheer girls. We're glad you could be here tonight to present the Dally M medal with, of course, in conjunction with the Prime Minister. Mr. Howard, I suppose it was a beauty before age on that particular occasion. I might have overstepped protocol, as it turns out, but I couldn't help myself.
You were right on the money.
I didn't think you'd mind. Now, of course, it's a very big month coming up for you. There are results that might swing on the smallest mistake. There are game plans to be laid, of course. And I believe there's an election coming up.
Yes, I've got my own final series. I'm worried about a few intercepts from the other side. And I don't want to get, blindsided. My worst fear as a St. George follower is a penalty try on full time. I'll try and avoid all of those, but I was saying to Jackie Kelly the other day, she of course is out from Penrith, and I said there's only one thing I really mind. I wouldn't mind if you lost in the next few weeks, and that's on Friday night, but as for the rest of it, we'll wait and see. But it's an interesting few weeks, and I'm enjoying it, but it's great to get along here. And can I just say, to the rugby league, what a terrific year they've had. I think the final series this year is so exciting, and I think we could have any result. My own team, they've given us a bit of a roller coaster ride, and I hope we peak just at the right time.
Now, of course, you presented the Dally M medal to Trent Barrett, a famous Dragon. You're a famous Dragon supporter back in 2000 on that night. There are no Dragons in contention here tonight, but how will they go and come to the finals time?
Well, I think they're capable on their night of beating anybody. They've had a great. They've had a season of ups and downs. They've had some brilliant wins and they've had some terribly disappointing losses. That one in Townsville was an example of it. But then they redeemed themselves a couple of weeks later. So anything can happen. But obviously the two form teams are the Bulldogs and the Roosters, and I understand that. But it's a great final series, and I'm hoping.
You're a busy man. Do you get the chance to watch and keep contact with what's happening in the NRL through Fox Sports?
Yeah, I do. I'm a great fan of Fox Sports. Great service. Yeah. You do a great job. Fantastic. 10 out of 10.
I couldn't miss the chance for the plug.
No. Thank you.
Thank you, John, for being here. And, of course, we still have a couple of rounds to go. Let's take a look and see what happens in round 25 as the countdown continues.
Round 25.
Two players in the top 10 receive votes in round 25. Craig Gow from Penrith against Parramatta, 2 votes. And Matt Orford from Melbourne against Cronulla, 3 votes.
So there you have it at the moment. Danny Medeiros, 3 points clear at the top of the table. But of course, with the votes still to come from round 26, anything could and quite possibly will happen, of course, given the tally count we've had over the last five or so rounds now. Danny Medeiros on 27 votes, Brett Finch on 24, Matt Orford on 23, Craig Gower, of course, what a season he's had for the Penrith Panthers on 21, and Nathan Hindmarsh also there on 21 with a couple of scoring rounds just recently through our count. Paul Rauhihi, a tremendous season himself, Kamali, Lockyer and Prince and Ryan also round out our top 10. We will see what happens, of course, just the last round to come. This is the action from round 26.
Round 26. And the Knights ruined the Tigers' hopes of appearing in their first finals campaign with a 10-point win in Newcastle. Robbie O'Davis departing the scene of many triumphs with a magnificent final game in the Knights' number one Guernsey.
Two players in the top 10 receive votes in round 26. Craig Gow from Penrith against St George Illawarra, 2 votes. And Brett Finch from the Roosters against Parramatta, 1 vote. They'll be happy in Newcastle tonight. The winner of the 2004 Dally M medal is Danny Medeiros.
Once again, a please a hand for the 2004 Dally M medal winner, Danny Medeiros. You haven't created history, but you've broken a 15-year streak where it was almost exclusively 5-8s and halfbacks who took out the Dally M medal. You've become just the third forward to win it after Ray Price and also Gavin Miller. It's a tremendous honour.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's been a very tough year for us at Newcastle, but you know, this makes it all worthwhile for me. And we also lost, you know, Andrew Johns during the year, so a lot of it went back onto my shoulders, and I enjoyed that challenge.
You mentioned Andrew Johns, of course. There must be something in the water up there because you guys have almost, apart from Preston Campbell, recently exclusively dominated the Dally M medal.
Yeah, that's right. Joey's obviously won the Norm Proven medal a lot of times as well. So yeah, it's great. It's just can't wait to get back home and share it with my teammates as well.
It was quite a tally count tonight, the like of which we haven't had for quite a long time now. You were a fair way behind early in the season, as it turned out. Got to within one of Brett Finch after 16 rounds. Given the fact that the Newcastle Knights only won 3 games in those final 10 games of the season, did you give yourself much hope going into the final 10 rounds?
No, not at all. I thought Brett was I thought he was going to streak it in, actually. I thought he had a great year, and just goes to show how close it was. And we had a couple of close games at the end of the year at Newcastle, so It's great to pull the points.
It must be like old home week up here with Jennifer beside you. A couple of Novocastrians.
Yeah, that's right. Everyone up there is so proud of Jennifer, and you know, she's a top girl.
Now, as far as... I'll agree with that. As far as the finish of the season, of course, it was well noted that you had a foot injury. You put yourself on an antibiotic drip in hospital the night before that last game against the Tigers. You had to battle your way through that final couple of months of the season.
Yeah, I obviously had the foot injury, but the hospital thing, it was just antibiotics. And, you know, a lot of important players up there at Newcastle left the club this year, and, you know, we wanted to finish off, and we finished off with a win.
Now, of course, you won't be taking part in the finals, but there is the Tri-Nation Series to come in October and also November. You have an eye to that now?
Yeah, that's right. That training squad was picked the other day, and we've got a few players in there at Newcastle. So, you know, we'll train for a few weeks and have to get on that plane and win the Tri-Series.
What will this mean to the family watching on back home now?
Yeah, hello, Mum and Dad. You know, they've been so much big supporters of mine, and they go everywhere with me, and... you know, it's just as much as mine, as theirs as mine.
Okay, let's take a look now at the votes as they ended up after 26 rounds. Of course, it was such a thrilling race as it turned out. Danny, you've won by 2 points, 25 points there for Brett Finch. Craig Gower finished on 23, also with Matt Orford on 23. Nathan Hindmarsh, 21 points. Paul Rauhihi, a tremendous season, and it continues on, of course, for the North Queensland Cowboys in their first finals campaign this week. Brett Camorley, Darren Lockyer, Michael Monaghan with 15 points, and also Scott Prince of the Tigers, another former Cowboy there. Thank you for joining us here this evening. Before we leave you, though, of course, let's meet once again the Team of the Year. We'll see some of these stars in action over the next 4 weeks, of course, and then after that, of course, in the Tri-Nation Series in October and November between Australia, Great Britain and, of course, New Zealand. Would you put your hand together for the Team of the Year in the Dally M's? What a star team they would make if there was a salary cap to fit them in. Of course, Darren Lockyer, Anthony Minicello, Nathan Hindmarsh, Darren Lockyer amongst them, and of course also Sean Timmins and Willie Tonga there in their number. Thank you for being here at the Sydney Town Hall tonight. Would you please once again thank the Prime Minister, Mr. John Howard, and Miss Universe, Jennifer Hawkins, for being with us tonight. And we hope you've enjoyed the tally count once again live from the Sydney Town Hall. Until we see you next time, it is good night.
Fox Sports Production.
Tonight on Fox Sports News, a hooker surprises them all, winning the Dally M Player of the Year.
It's been a very tough year for us at Newcastle, but, you know, this makes it all worthwhile for me.
And some consolation for Newcastle after missing the finals. Hooker Danny Badiris was named the Dally M Player of the Year. A night for wives and partners to share league spotlight. Former Knights cheer girl and now Miss Universe, Jennifer Hawkins, also strolled the red carpet rather than the catwalk. Badiris beat hot favourite Brett Finch for the game's highest individual honour.
Yeah, I thought Finch, he streaked it in. I thought he was going to win. So, no, it's got to show. It was a very tight polling system, and, you know, I was just so grateful I got there, come out on top.
Darren Lockyer won the Proven Summons Medal as the fans' choice of best player. Brisbane teammate Carmichael Hunt named Rookie of the Year. The Dogs picked up Captain and Coach of the Year, and the Roosters' Craig Fitzgibbon was named the best rep player.